You're just about to release a new double album under Avantasia. How did it end up being a double album?
It was too long for a single album. So that's when it became Twin. we did the Scarecrow album, and we had so much material back then when we composed the Scarecrow album. We were producing already a lot of basics for enough songs to make the Scarecrow Part 2 as well. We just said, okay, maybe we're gonna enhance it, you know, and do two more tracks. Then we released the Scarecrow, went back to first did a tour, did an Edguy tour. Did an Edguy album before. Then we went back to work on what was supposed to be the Scarecrow Part 2. And there were all of a sudden so many more ideas. I didn't want to just complete the old material that had already been written. I wanted to compose new stuff and let the creativity flow. And I went on and it became 12 songs, 14 songs, 18 songs, 20 songs. And we realized 125 minutes is way too much material to put it on one piece of plastic. So we said, okay, it's going to be actually a double album, but I didn't like the idea of calling it a double album, because usually double albums, it's 10 tracks plus instrumentals and spoken words and, you know, passages where the warrior, you know, goes to the battlefield and kills, you know, Nostradamus and, you know, all those people coming together. And I didn't want it, you know, I wanted to make sure people get that it's 11 songs from start to finish, 11 songs on each album, material, choruses, great choruses, not one instrumental song. I wanted it to be, it really demands a lot from the listener, because it's very intensive material. So I wanted to make sure people take it for as what it is. And that's why I had to really give it two titles, two cover artworks. And that's why it became The Wicked Symphony and Angel of Babylon. And I think you can either take one album and you will really find it's one album, one great album with 11 great tracks and no fillers. And that message had to come across by separating them.
So will it sound like the Scarecrow, or has the sound changed over the years?
Well, you know, as some of the stuff had been written during that era, it's going to be pretty much the same direction. It's more diversified, because this time I got 22 tracks to diversify the material. Last time I just got 11 tracks. I think the core is very, very Scarecrow-ish. The core is very metal opera-like. I mean, the core is there, my songwriting. But we, you know, after having done so many records, you really have to take a turn to the left and to the right and to the left and to the right again and explore what's left and right of your path, just so it remains exciting. And I think that's what we did, that's what I did, what Sasha and I did, and that was very important.
Okay. Now, at the end of last year, you wrote on the internet that money has been a bit of a problem, and that, you know, in the future you might not have enough money to get so many guests or such a big production on the future albums. Are these next two albums sort of going to be the last of their kind, in a way?
You know, if I would be a good promoter of my own stuff, I would say yes. Honestly speaking, I hope no. I was not afraid. I was asked about it, and I wanted to make that message come across, that I'm a little concerned about where our music scene is heading to. Because I understand, people don't have as much money as they used to have. It's quite easy. It's just a couple of mouse clicks, and you get, you know, the full discography of Iron Maiden, you know, to your computer. It's very tempting. I understand that. Still, so many people put so much blood and sweat, and hopefully not tears, but a lot of effort into the production of an album. Photographers, people working for the record label, people working in the studio, the producer, guest musicians, the guy who paints the cover artwork, the guy who does the booklet. So many people involved, and they all would like, you know, to be even paid to do that in the future. They don't get paid royally, but they want to make the money in the future as well. And that's, if you want to have that grade of a work, you have to pay people properly. And for that, those Avantasia records, I really did everything as good as possible. I needed 10 backing vocalists. I got 10 backing vocalists. We wanted to record in an old cinema, which was quite expensive. We did it. Whatever needed to be done, we did it. We did a couple of photo sessions. I hired like 20 musicians to play on that album. There's members of Kiss, The Scorpions, Judas Priest. I never said, please do it for free. I paid everybody. And that's just what I wanted to make. This is not a demo production done in my little basement. This is really the most expensive thing I've ever done, and I wanted that to come across. And said, people, please, be fair. If you like it, please get it, because otherwise, I'm sure, if it doesn't sell, the record label will not give me a budget again.
So, looking back to the first two Avantasia albums, Avantasia has become a lot more sort of radio-friendly in recent years. What reason is there for this?
What kind of radio are you speaking of? I don't know any radio that's more friendly to me. I remember when we did when Lost in Space was sent out to the radio stations, because it was a top 10 hit. It was a top 10 hit even before it got played. I have to say that, you know, it was no sellout here. But then when it went to the radio stations, they said, first of all, Tobias Sammet doesn't sound cool, the name. I said, well, I'm not going to call myself Milli Vanilli or Adam Ant or just for the sake of being played on the radio. And the second is, they said, I'm too old. So you get that, I'm too old. I mean, I know I got circles under my eyes, but too old, come on. I was not even 30 back then. So that's when I realized what radio had turned into. And this is not radio friendly. It's not radio friendly to even some people say, oh, he sounds like Bon Jovi now. I can't agree. But even if I would, when was the last time you've heard a new band show a song like Living on a Prayer on commercial radio? They, you know, a new band who does that, they don't get played. So, no. It's just I think I'm more diverse now.
Okay. So, you've taken Avantasia on tour once before in 2008, I think. Is there any chance of another tour?
Well, there is a theoretical chance, but I think it's very little, because I don't think it's going to happen. It was a great experience. We headlined Wacken one night. We headlined Masses of Rock. Headlining, all of a sudden I was asked, it was my first live appearance with that project, all of a sudden they asked me to headline all those festivals that I had played several times with Edgar before. And it was a great time for everybody of us, playing 200,000 people in Wacken. We did a documentary, it's going to be out maybe next year, you know, about the tour and shot some of the shows, so there's going to be a DVD. But I don't really think it's going to be possible to get all the people together once more, because that was the biggest problem back then, to organize it and have everybody available. And I don't think this is going to happen again. It's really, really, you can't do it just for two or three shows. You have to rehearse, you have a lot of startup expenses. So I would want to do it. It was a dream, and I would want to dream that dream again, but I don't think it's going to happen.